Hello, everybody. Welcome back to the Hearthstone Championship Tour. We're about to jump into the match between Kit Kat and Lucas. But before we do that, I'm actually standing by one of the new faces on the Hearthstone casting desk. It is Cora from Team Vicious Syndicate. So I just want to give you a chance to sort of introduce yourself and give the viewers at home a little bit more of an idea about who you are. So give us a background of how you got started in Hearthstone and how you got started with casting.
Yeah, you actually just pulled me off of a chair. I was getting ready to watch a match, and he's like, we're interviewing you. I'm like, I have gum in my mouth. I should probably do something about that. Yeah, I started playing Hearthstone over 2 years ago, right when Open Beta started. Started really casually. My brother introduced me to the game, and I was like, I'm in college. I don't have any money to spend on card games. I'll just play Arena far too much. So I did that, and eventually when I had a more full collection, I was lucky that I got in early and was able to save up gold to buy packs and not have to put in too much money. And then just sort of went from there. Eventually, I started playing some open tournaments. I decided to become a little bit more competitive, hit Legend for, I think, like 18 times now.
Became a Secret Paladin expert?
You just keep bringing that up. People are just going to keep hating on me for it. I'm a Secret Paladin expert. I don't know. I like it. Whatever. But yeah, I mean, it's been a great ride, and now I'm a broadcast student, so I figured if I can put Hearthstone and broadcasting together, mm-hmm. I mean, what better is there for me to be doing? So entered the So You Think You Can Cast Hearthstone competition, and now I'm here.
Yeah, and the rest is history. Well, I want to get your thoughts on what you've thought of the matches so far. Is there anything that surprised you? Is there any deck choices or players that have advanced or have been eliminated that surprised you?
Yeah, I think it's been really great so far. I've been really surprised with the Latin American players' deck choices. Mm-hmm. I know I was really excited to see that mid-range paladin. That's something that you don't see very often at all. The very first match I casted, Fibonacci brought a Demon Handlock, which is like, you know, you've seen so much Demon Handlock now, you're not really excited. But when you're only expecting Reno Lock and Zoo, it was actually really exciting for some reason, just to see some variation. So I've been really happy with the deck choices so far, and I think not as many upsets as last week with Europe. We've had, some solid players, some superstars still performing very well, which, we normally expect. But I think there have been some less well-known players that have really been showing that they've got what it takes.
Yeah, and we're only a little bit more than halfway through the day, so there's plenty of time for some upsets or for some crazy new decks to surface. But thank you for answering some questions.
Thank you for having me.
We look forward to seeing you more on the desk. But we are going to send it back over to the desk where our boys are sitting by, ready for the next match.
Thank you very much, TJ and Cora. That's right. No more questions, Your Honor. The interrogation is over. It's time for more Hearthstone. I am joined on the desk by Raven and Kevin once more. Hope you guys have been enjoying the matches so far. What's been your favorite part of the day so far, Raven?
I think just having a good mixture, as Cora sort of alluded to in the interview there, where it's like we've seen some of the big names, the pro players, continue to go far and progress, while seeing some of the lesser known names actually, start to make a name for themselves within this, taking down some of these more known players.
Yeah, that's right. We've gotten to see a good mix of players, and we're going to have another one coming up here. We have a Brazilian versus a U.S. I don't want to ignore you as well, Kevin. What's been some of the highlights for you personally?
I mean, the whole tournament has been phenomenal, and I think we've gotten to see some incredible Hearthstone, but also get to tell some really cool stories, right? For me as a journalist, and that's where I kind of come from originally, I like seeing some of these people that we don't know as much about and can now tell their story, how they got into Hearthstone, where they started, what it is that they want to accomplish, and there's definitely some of that going on today.
Do you feel vindicated that Just Dude is doing pretty well?
Like a little bit, yeah. I mean, it's nice to see somebody who's got his own take on what's happening go through. But these players are honestly just as interesting to me. My first love was Control Warrior, and I'm sad to see Kit Kat's Warrior get banned out.
That's right. Kit Kat's a player who has made a name for himself through the Warrior class, and it looks like that is banned. Now, an interesting ban from Kit Kat's point of view. He chooses not the Paladin, not even the Warrior on the other side, but he chooses the Rogue. Take out. What do you think about that, Raven?
Yeah, it's a really tough one because, again, we sort of mentioned in one of the earlier casts where Rogue has really strong potential to take out a lot of decks. As long as, you can get that card draw and actually, pull off those combos, it's really powerful in general. But I think like Lucas's lineup overall isn't so standard. There's no Druid and there's no Warlock, which is definitely not too common that we've seen so far. So it's one of those ones where okay, so I'm not going to ban out one of the core popular decks. So I was like, so I'll just ban what I feel like not playing against more than anything.
Well, I can understand the Warrior, definitely, because the Warrior, and when you look at the recent times, KitKats hasn't actually been playing Control Warrior. He's been playing a lot of Patron Warrior, which is problematic in the large scheme of the entire metagame. However, the banning the Rogue is just very unconventional because we don't see that class very often. Also, the Brazilians are a little bit weird. You're not sure what to expect from them, and Rogue is one of the most volatile classes. It has such explosive potential. It also can just beat itself. I think he's taking out a lot of the uncertainty in that Rogue deck, I think. What do you think, Kevin?
I mean, I have to agree. And honestly, the Rogue deck that I just cast, right, we just saw Rogue work out super well for Chess Dude. It does contest classes that want control of the board really well. There's so many good removal tools in Rogue to just clear a board of minions. This is a really smart pick, I think, to try and protect himself, looking at the fact that he is probably running decks in Paladin and Warlock, where he does want to make sure that he's able to take control of the board and assert his win condition that way.
Sure. I mean, it worked in the past probably for him, and we'll see if it works out this time as well. This is where it really starts getting down to the nitty-gritty, because every win increases your chances that much more. To go to the top eight, let's go into game number one. We have KitKats versus Lucas. Looks like we're going to get the cam up for KitKats in a second. In the meantime, we're going to start things off with the, well, looks like it'll be a Patron Warrior up against the Secret Paladin. A matchup that, at least on paper, should be pretty good for the Patron. Although, the more I play it, the more I feel like it's actually pretty even across the board.
Yeah, I think one of the key points in this matchup is the Patron Warrior being able to do the Patron things on turn five. So they want that Death Bite, they want the Inner Rage and the Patron to get on board. And if they can get those Patrons on board before Mysterious Challenger comes out, they're in an amazing spot and can almost just take the win from there. Whereas, you know, Patron is a deck that can whiff sometimes and not really get what it needs. So if the Challenger comes out before we see any Patrons build up onto the board, the Paladin can actually just overpower the Warrior and just push through.
I mean, the challenge absolutely for the Patron player here is knowing when and how to use your removal. You have to play very carefully around the assumption that you're going to need things like your Executes to respond to Mysterious Challenger or Tyrion down the road. You need resources left, and if you've used all the gas in your tank to get that far in the game, you're going to start to struggle as Patron, because even the fact that you can trade really efficiently here isn't necessarily going to be enough.
Right. I think the big thing that you have to also consider as well is, you know, when can you really flip the board? Because it's, you know, one of the problems that really exists is that the Secret Paladin is going to continue to put on this pressure. And in a lot of ways, people often misconstrue the Secret Paladin as an aggro deck when it really feels a lot like a board control, similar to the old days of Zoo, right? With Zoo people, they always thought it's like, this is an aggro deck. Well, it's not really necessarily an aggro deck. It just happens to be a very fast deck. I think the same type of concept is here. KitKat's also in a very interesting spot where he thought that maybe this is what credits to the noble sacrifice or even hero powering, but he realizes there's also more opportune moments as time goes on. And I think the Knife Juggler, even though it's more painful to lose that, it's still an okay thing to play there.
Right, he's just trying to establish board presence. Although I have to admit, I was a little scared there that you were going to say Secret Patron, and that's a deck I never want to play against.
Yeah, Secret Patron seems to be not very good right now, but if there's
new meta.
Yeah, if there's an Enraged Challenger that comes out and pulls random secrets from the game into the battlefield, I don't know what would happen at that point.
Definitely too scared to think about. But we saw KitKats there get the nice combo of using the mini-bot shield and then being able to re-enable that shield with the addition of a taunt with the Coghammer and clear off the first Frothing Berserker. But Lucas has responded pretty well, put two more minions on the board, one of which is another Frothing, and still has that weapon to go. So KitKats really has to work out what the best way is to deal with this board, because the second you leave a Frothing Berserker, it is the second you start to take a lot of phase damage.
Right, and both these players are in interesting positions in the sense that KitKats doesn't have any really great later turn lines of play right now, and having both Muster for Battles in hand is not necessarily a really great place to be. But on the flip side, Lucas doesn't have any of his card draw or really good sort of long-term I want to set up how to do Patron things cards available to him either.
Yeah, I think he's definitely going to be reliant on this Death Bite doing some work. It's going to sort of negate KitKats' ability to play these two musters to a certain extent if he can just get that Death Bite locked in potentially next turn. But he also still has the Whirlwind for, you know, like super emergencies where it's like, if I can't get this quick enough and I feel the board running away, Whirlwind definitely helps just clear up those 1-1 tokens.
Certainly. And another thing to consider too is that Acolyte of Pain was a really important draw, because one of the things that KitKats evaluates when he's about to hit this Frothing Berserker is how much do I want to play into like a Battle Rage for my Warrior opponent? If he has a Battle Rage, he's helping him draw cards immediately before he has to do any action. And the earlier you can draw cards into turn is generally more available routes that you can take and decision trees that ends up expanding. So I do like the attack, given that, you know, you do want to be able to get ahead of the board that way, but it's one thing to evaluate. And with that Acolyte of Pain, I feel like the Patron still might have an opportunity to turn the board here because the remaining cards in Paladin are not that great.
Yeah, definitely low impact at this point in the game when there is a Deathbite, just, you know, just sat there ready and waiting to hit that second proc and the Whirlwind effect. But True Silver is actually pretty reasonable pickup. It's a bit rough because he already has the card camera equipped, but I think removing this Acolyte and just only giving the Patron one draw, and as you said, Frodan, like, if the Acolyte can take some damage, still live, and then a Battle Rage comes on, like, this needs so much card draw for the Patron, and that's what they need to win almost any matchup.
Right, at this point, the Patron player is actually in a lot of trouble because even though he's technically probably feeling pretty good about the fact that Kit Kats can't develop his board, he also doesn't get to cycle anywhere near as efficiently as he would like, and that's a core part of how you're trying to win the game as the Patron player.
Yep, and we see the Ghoul pickup there. Again, not so effective at the moment. Really good to just stave off these low minions that are in Kit Kat's hand, but just not enough presence. We're not seeing the Patrons come on board or anything really too big. He does have Grom, but obviously that's going to play a part, I think, much later in the game. But in this position, he might even be forced to use Grom to just, like, trade against one of the, like, you know, maybe bigger minions that Kit Kats may draw into.
Is there room to be aggressive at all? If you have an opportunity to use Deathbite, it's 8 damage, assuming you can hit the face twice. Then Grommash with that is also 10 damage, and you're working at, I mean, pretty aggressive health counts here. I mean, he started to pose at 23, but that's only 5 damage you're missing, and you already have 2 of it on board.
Yeah, and there's a potential we've seen no inner rages yet. So, you know, there is that, you know, opening for more damage.
The challenge, though, for Lucas going into turn 6 is he is evaluating the potential that there's going to be a big swing turn happening here. He's waiting for Mysterious Challenger, Lotheb, something significant to hit the board, and he doesn't want to be put in a position where he has nothing on board to contest. Now he's maybe going to be feeling the effects of that decision because there's now a very, very full board, and he doesn't have that primed Deathbite ready to go.
Right, not to mention that if he picks up Dr. Boom or some other larger minion, he wouldn't be able to play that and the weapon. So he was weighing his options and really feeling like he can take it a little bit slower. Ends up picking up a convenient mana usage with the Armorsmith. This Noble Sacrifice will take the hit, so he has to attack with this Armorsmith first. Otherwise, he'll take less damage on it by triggering it, but I don't think that's necessarily worth it.
No, I mean, this is a really great position, honestly. As the Warrior player, I mean, you know that you're now sacrificing one of your Armorsmiths. At some point, you're going to lose it, whether it's to your own Whirlwind effect or to the Whirlwind effect from Deathbite down the road. But you're getting to a point where you have a fair amount of health available to you. There's not a lot that the Paladin can actually do to close this game out from 2 cards in hand.
Yeah, and Lucas there doing an interesting play. He had the decision, do I want to clear the board and maybe play around something like Blessing of Kings, or do I value my Whirlwind too high? So kind of interesting to me that he had the mana to clear the board off, and he does lose the Armorsmith, but he still gains 2 armor and a fairly healthy Armorsmith still on the board. So kind of interesting. He just, you know, he killed the Creeper and then just left all of the tokens alive. But, you know, just really wants to hold on to that Whirlwind.
It's tough. I mean, as the Patron player, you're really hoping to see faster cycling than this. I mean, we're fairly deep into this game, and he's got no card draw available to him. He's got very limited options. A big Battle Rage coming down would be very significant, but at this point, right now, you're looking at this board and thinking you're going to struggle to actually fight your way back into this game because you just haven't been able to dig for the stuff that you need to end the game.
Yeah, and this is going to be a scary moment as Kit Kats has just played a secret. It could be one of many things, but if Grom comes down, then this is going to be very unfortunate very quickly.
This is so bad.
Oh my goodness. He's not
Lucas, shake of the head. Can you believe it?
Yeah, I wouldn't even want to look Grom in the face. That's not how you treat your finisher at all. And look at the response, Dr. Boom. You know, I really love the subtle thing that Kit Kat did, which was, you know what, there's Deathbite. I'm not going to extend to the board with the Muster for Battle or the Blessing of Kings. I'm just going to keep it as options. And as a result, got so far ahead in tempo. That was an amazing swing.
Yeah, this Patron pickup is also a fairly significant one because now we're going to see Lucas respond and do a lot of work to establish a board that Secret Paladin has no obvious response to. But in this position, you have to wonder if this is actually going to be enough, right? We don't know what's going to happen. These Boombots could actually make this really bad.
Oh, really good.
Okay. Really good. So this is tough now. If you are the Secret Paladin player, you feel good about that outcome, right? But KitKats is also looking at this and thinking, honestly, he's at 15 health. There's not a lot of room here to make any mistakes or not draw into something that really helps you get control of this board back.
Yeah, exactly. And even the attack to face there was just like, I'm not even going to try and make Dr. Boom get onto low health. He couldn't actually kill it. So he's just going to go face, go aggressive, because these patrons, although they only attack for three, when you have a board full of them, it's actually quite a lot of damage. So KitKats might actually focus on clearing off the patrons here, as I don't know if he has enough damage to actually just ignore them and hope it goes away. But on the other side of that, he could try and trade because the warrior has no cards. So the ability to try and generate additional patrons is pretty much non-existent now.
Yeah, I like that you really just milk the rest of the board here, you know? Like, really try to force your opponent to pick up an answer. I like that he targeted the weak one, shut down the value on the Battle Rage, because the warrior is just going to pick up more cards that synergize with other cards. Very similar to how a priest deck works, where you have Circle of Healing, but you don't have the Akana Soul Priest or even the Northshire Cleric. Executes, okay, it's reasonable. And also, I think one of the things is you probably just want to attack face because you're going to put your opponent down to 6 health, so you're going to hope for one more weapon draw potentially to finish this game.
Unfortunately, though, for KitKats, he just doesn't have any really smart plays here. As much as you really want to just get things on the board here, you honestly can't afford to use Muster. You can't put that on the board and risk giving your opponent the ability to create more patrons. Or maybe you can.
Yeah, I think because he has the Comp Spirit and the Avenge to follow up with, even if this patron creates, you know, a copy of itself by trading into a 1-1, there's still a lot of power on the board, and there's no real way to deal with that competitive spirit on all those tokens, and then the Avenge that's gained from killing off one of the tokens. So, and as we said before, the Warrior is only top decking, so a card like Inner Rage, yes, he can generate more, but it's going to be a real struggle for him.
Well, now he knows one of them surely is Competitive Spirit. I think he was anticipating a Noble Sacrifice. But when you know your opponent dumps the hand, there's really nothing you can do about it. You just stick to your biggest win condition. I think a lot of people there might be tempted to start trading into minions, but it's like you said, get the damage in. So now that you know you're just one draw away, always putting pressure on, and it's up to the Paladin to generate a response with Tyrion or a Cockhammer. Or something else.
Yeah, and especially putting him to three. So Fiery War Axe is out, as well as like another Deathbite now. So it's just an instant potential win.
Right, I mean, unfortunately, the Secret Paladin player just, as a general rule, doesn't have any way to recover from being behind like that. You don't have any opportunity to throw up a really big taunt or heal yourself. Those are typically not core inclusions in Secret Paladin. And even if they are, they're very narrow options. You don't have a lot of them in your deck. So right now...
Oh, man. Where is it? I don't really see the Paladin struggle this much in the late game, but that's always a possibility. Now you have to also wonder, can I die by leaving this Acolyte onto the board? And there is a possibility if your opponent's playing Cool Taskmaster. However, these days, it seems like if you're playing the Dread Corsair list, you're gravitating more towards what Crane likes to do, having loot hoarders and not really the Cool Taskmasters.
Yeah, but there's also a possibility of a second in a Rage. We've only seen one, right?
I believe we saw two.
Oh, did we see two?
We see a patron drawn, and then
This is really scary, though. He's going to get... Three additional cards here. And if there's anything at all left in this deck,
just a single Fiery War
Any
Axe
weapon.
Would do. Another Battle Rage? Wow. I'm ready.
Oh, and the Cruel Taskmaster, but he doesn't have anything to use it on.
Belcher. Okay. I mean, this is still a game. We still have the opportunity for Tyrion to lock it out. You know, interesting calls here. The Big Game Hunter and the Cruel Taskmaster. So it's less emphasis on the cycle and a lot heavier emphasis on tempo. So, you know, Lucas, some of these cards are pretty good. However, he's going to need one thing to survive, and right now, currently nothing will.
Yeah, I think the only benefit here is Lucas is on still a good amount of health, and he was up to, like, I think, +7 armor as well, like, the previous turn or so. So he's still got time to draw into these cards, and he has just cycled through so many cards, like, unless the Fire War Axe is literally the last card in his deck, he must be drawing close to it at this point.
Well, and unfortunately, right, if you're looking at KitKats' position on board right now, he's still a solid 2 to 3 turns away, depending on how things go. Never mind.
Well, a secret also was played, but I think as your Lucas, you have to go for that possibility. Even if it is Noble Sacrifice number 2, you have to try and set it up for the next turn to kill, and it is going to be game number 1 in the books. The Secret Paladin just running really dry there. No ability to hit into the late game curve whatsoever.
Yeah, it was really rough for the Paladin. I think like the Warrior just about held on long enough, and then you know the Battle Rage into Battle Rage is pretty much sealed the deal, being able to cycle so deep. Because if he couldn't pull that card draw off, then he wouldn't have got that Death Spite anywhere near as quickly, and the game would have ended just through attrition from Kit Kats more than anything with all those small minions on board.
I mean, ultimately, that's what happened either way. Really, what we're looking at in that matchup is both players forced to top deck, no options left in the tank, and the fact that Patron can then dig very deep and find an answer is ultimately what decided that game.
Yeah, that's right. So we were able to see Lucas take a very important game number one. And, you know, you bring Patron Warrior because it does have pretty strong matchups across the board, especially against decks like Zoo. It's still decent against Druid, yeah. Like, very well. So I like that inclusion in the lineup. And, you know, Kit-Kats has played that deck so much that he's very familiar with its strengths and weaknesses as well. Great game number one. I do want to point out that during the break, I pointed out that Lucas did beat VLPS to get to this point. And then I said that was an upset. And then, you know, one of my friends, Bunny Muffin's like, that's not an upset. And I'm like, well, no one really knows too much about Lucas, so you can't really say he's the favorite just because you're friends with him and you're familiar with his style. But the more I see him play, I can understand why he said that. VLPS is a great player, but I think Lucas is showing his skills for sure.
Right, I mean, VLPS did come in higher seeded. So on a strict technicality, we're going to call it an upset. But
yeah.
We're seeing such incredible play out of all of the South American, Latin American players today. I don't think anyone expected that coming into this series.
Well, the ones that make it here are clearly the ones who have put in not only the time into to learning the game, but also the time to rank up and get a lot of these points. You know, a lot of the points in the tournaments, you have to really fight some big and competitive fields. I mean, you've done it too, Raven. You've won one of those online cups to get like 2 points, right? Or 1 point. It was
I think
so
it was
competitive.
Three. Yeah.
Oh, I apologize. I'm telling you, short.
Come on, brother. Come on. It was like
three points.
Come on. Yeah,
that's right.
I think like when you see a lot of these players just constantly battling through these online tournaments, it takes a lot of time. And you see guys like probably like Lucas, where he's just like every single tournament I'm playing in, and you just commit so much to it. And you see it pays off though, because first VLPS, and then potentially next Kit Kats. So where are you taking down these big names?
Yeah, that's right. And it's just one step at a time, too. A lot of people look at the entire field, but you're not playing against Strifecrow and Tides and all these people at the same time. It's just one at a time, and eventually you just build a quite impressive resume working through the elimination brackets. And again, this is if you lose here, you still have a much higher chance versus if you lose in the first round. I think you have to play 4 or 5 extra series, which is really hard at
right.
this stage.
And not to sell either of these players short, right? Like, Kit Kats is also undefeated up to this point. We are in the upper bracket, and one of them is still going to have the opportunity to fight their way back through the lower bracket. So Kit Kats is not on the down and out. He's down one game in a series against a player that we don't know a ton about just yet, but he does still have the opportunity to showcase his skills later on as well.
You know, the thing about Kit Kats is that he's sort of, you know, been disappointing relative to the hype for a long time. And I say that because, you know, first of all, Kit Kats is a friend of mine. I'm going full Stephen A. Smith. Now listen, you know, Kit Kats is a dear friend of mine. I don't know whatever he says. But the whole point is that he hasn't actually lived up to the billing that people have put him up to the entire time. However, I think it's really unwarranted just because he hasn't had many platforms to succeed on. A lot of his friends, you know, Chalky, for example, or you look at some other people who have competed in NA for a long time, they've gotten a lot of invites to tournaments, but Kit Kats doesn't travel very often to events. And whenever he does, he still does reasonably well, you know, qualifying from open brackets and being able to make deep runs.
Right. I mean, we've talked about this a fair bit in preparation and throughout the day when we aren't physically right here on the desk. A lot of these players earned their way here through just playing on the ladder and succeeding there. And Kit Kats has a long and storied history of doing really well on the ladder. There's also a range of players who earned their keep and got here today by doing really well in community cups and small online tournaments. And there's a very different skill set that goes into those two ways of making your way into the America's Winter Preliminary. I think there is a definite advantage, and we're seeing it. All throughout the day, we've seen it. The people who got here with just ladder finishes, some of them are doing really well. Chalky is one of those players. But some of them are not as experienced at how to play in the tournament environment. There's a different kind of fatigue, a different kind of mentality. And that's going to be showcased all weekend here.
Yeah, definitely. So, you know, we're going to keep an eye out for how they're going to do. But again, I just want to emphasize that this is a really good result for Kit Kats so far, just because I think since he's been there from the beginning, but yet not have many opportunities, he's just flown under the radar when they look at players who are pretty good. You know, in fact, it's somewhat ironic that Fibonacci is getting so much attention for him playing Warriors so prominently on the ladder and in tournaments, and yet Kit Kats just kind of falls to the side.
Yeah, I think it's as well to take note that everyone even in this tournament has actually put in a good result already.
Because they've
got in like the top 128 or so in the whole region. And then every single win on that is just getting further and further into the tournament. And even like, you know, top 32, top 16, it's a really good finish for these guys. So, you know, it's a good result in itself, never mind if they don't quite make it all the way.
Mm-hmm. Right. Every one of these players either finished in the top 100 on the ladder at some point in the winter seasons, or they've had a podium placement in some kind of community cup. In many cases, they've had both and multiple of both. And that's a huge finish no matter how you slice it. None of these players aren't really, really strong. Even the people who won and are here as Tavern Heroes, they had to go and play through, in some cases, very large tournaments and beat notable players who also were trying to qualify for the Winter Preliminary that way.
So that's a good opportunity to talk to you guys about how you can qualify as well. The season ends after the Winter Championships, meaning that the points reset as a soft reset. So if you want to be like these guys, like Lucas and Kit Kats, I would suggest getting to work now, because the points at the end of the season for February do count for the Spring Championship.
Yeah, and also if you do want to be like Lucas, bring Murloc Paladin. Because that's what we're about to see, guys, and this is going to be a really fun deck.
Favorite deck, Raven. I can talk about this deck for a long time.
You are sat in the right seat for that.
Oh, it's so good. Murloc Paladin is one of my favorite decks. However, I do recognize that it's not the best call for the metagame every time you play it. But I think for the surprise factor, and if you're a very good control player, it can be one of the most impactful and effective decks that we've seen in a long time.
I mean, I'm going to go ahead and say Lucas has the advantage right out the gate because his Paladin is golden and Kit Kats is not.
Well, I think that would be really intimidating for Kit Kats because it's like, wow, he's putting a lot of time as Paladin. But the first thing that you always think of is if he has a golden Paladin, I wonder what deck he's played to get there. It's like, wow, Kit Kats is kind of honorable. He doesn't actually spam Paladin at all.
It's a little bit crazy, but I think pretty swiftly Kit Kats is going to discover when you see a loot hoarder dropped from a Paladin that this probably isn't secret. So then he'll very quickly have to change his game plan because these are two very, very different decks.
Right. Now, what's really interesting is that Lucas has cards like the Loot Hoarder in there, which is already a little bit of a different take than what you're used to seeing. A lot of the flexible spots in this deck are cards like the Acolyte of Pain, like the Outdoor Peacekeeper, and you see some people like Kalento really favor cards like Dr. Boom in the deck, when traditionally people don't really expect that in a combo Murloc deck.
This is also going to be really tough because Kit Kats has to evaluate how much he wants to play into the board at any given time, because there is so much removal in Murloc Paladin. There are so many tools available to clear the board, reset the game state, cue your hero back to full. At some point, Secret Paladin is either not going to have control of the board or have nothing left in the tank.
Yeah, I think one of the valid tactics against a deck like this, and it's very similar when you play against like a Reno deck, sometimes you just have to go for it and hope they don't have it, right? And just hope they don't have the ability to just instant clear the board. Because if you try and take it slow, that's exactly what the Murloc Paladin wants. They want the game to go late. They want to play the Murlocs, get them killed off, and then just play the combo. Well, the combo, the one card combo at the end on 10 mana, and then just push so much damage, you just win through the game through that. So if you don't go all in as the other deck, depending on the deck, of course, but I think Secret Paladin's one of them, you just, you know, hence where we see the Shredder now. He's ignored the two Doomsayers, it's going to wipe the board, but he still has two tokens and whatever drops out of Shredder. So you just have to keep the pressure high and hope they can't play enough cards to sustain.
That's pretty annoying. Well, you know, the fact that Murlocs have to die is pretty convenient. It is only two of the Murlocs, though, and there's five total in the deck, unless there's, well, at least in our version. By the way, the secret being drawn out of the deck on this turn is such a big deal, because the Mysterious Challenger deck, if you could just keep clearing the board and they're just drawing secrets, you're going to be in trouble.
And Lucas was unfortunately punished by having to play both of his Doomsayers at the same time. So now he doesn't have all the same options that he used to have. He does have here the ability at least to hit Pyromancer into Equality. That will do a lot if he chooses to go that route. But he's really got to hold on here and save time until he can use his suite of removal as well as that Lay on Hands. That's really his key turn right now. which could happen as early as next turn with coins still in hand, to give him some more options in hand and also survive a little bit longer.
Yeah, I think the issue now and why Kit Kat looks like he's doing pretty well in this matchup so far is that he has gone aggressive. And if Coin Lay on Hands comes out, yeah, you know, it draws three more cards, heals for eight. But Kit Kat will just put so much power on the board that the heal for eight, you know, he just returns that and more the next turn. And that's a whole turn for Lucas. He doesn't clear the board with Lay on Hands, you know, and he has to then catch up afterwards. He's already on so low health, and this is what you just have to do against this deck. End it really quickly, so then all their big removals and even, like, Equality Consecrate 6 mana, and, you know, like, Wild Pyro is a full clear with 4, but you just don't want them to be able to play that as well as other things like card draw as well.
So if you're anticipating your opponent playing a Lay on Hands, you want to be as aggressive as possible with Dr. Boom, but if you anticipate some kind of board clear, then you would play the Sludge Belcher. I think that Dr. Boom is still pretty strong, given that even if they Pyro Quality, they only have a few more mana, they can't really heal. Also, the Boombot still can do a lot of damage.
The Boombots could take him to one.
You might just draw game-ending damage.
Yeah, but this is probably the correct decision across the board here, is proc all the secrets, get all that stuff in play, use the Pyromancer Equality to clear the board with a body on board that hopefully absorbs at least one of those Boombot hits, and that will give him one more full turn. He's going to be able to get that Lay on Hands off, and that buys him a chance to get to that first Anyfin, which he can, if he has to, just use as a way to get board control and stay in the game. And the Secret Paladin doesn't, behind this, have a whole lot of ways to do a lot of work.
Yeah, I think one of the...
Oh my goodness!
All Boombots can do that, and I was gonna say one of the key cards to continue this game would be Tyrion as well. So this is gonna get very rough very quickly for Lucas. I just don't think it. Healbot into Humility is gonna sort of slow the game down a little bit, but it's gonna be very difficult for this to go anywhere, especially with Noble Sacrifice, Avenge, and the Sludge Belcher next turn. Because again, it's representing so much power, and Lucas is only on two cards.
Now, the Mysterious Challenger draw number 2 might look really awesome on paper, but there's not many secrets. Actually, I'm willing to wager no secrets are going to get pulled out from this. It's just a big body at this point, a 6-6, so that way you can really threaten the board. I don't mind pulling the two secrets out as well. Just go hard. Just go hard! Just really, all you want to do is end the game before your opponent can stay alive. But the Lay on Hands into whatever else he draws, it's still a really scary to assume that you've got this game.
Yeah, I mean, this is still very much a game that has the potential to go either way. The Murloc Paladin can't obviously win outright anytime soon. You got an opponent that's high health, has a lot of tools available to them. This is, Coghammer alone is another way to sort of clear the board, add taunt effects.
My goodness.
I think this is just too much pressure now.
Yeah.
Like, what card can Lucas actually draw that's going to recover this game enough to end it? Because if he plays anything now, and clears the board, the whole board's empty, his opponent's still on 28, and your only real win condition is the second anything, and then hoping the Murloc survive long enough to power through and eventually kill your opponent. Whereas Secret Paladin's going to have so much pressure, and there's no weapon removal, so if he kills this Tyrion, that's one of the taunt minions on the board, he's going to get the Ashbringer.
I mean, I think honestly what he's going to do here is he's going to fish with a 4-mana Solemn Vigil for that second Equality. It's the only way he's got something out of this game. He's not going to find it, so now he's probably stuck here. He doesn't have enough answers left to get enough damage off the board to stay in the game here. Even if he Consecrates, there's enough damage on the board.
Yeah, he's dead many times over, so he just passes, letting Kit Kat get the final hit in. Very honorable, you know, not really conceding. There is a slight chance Kit Kat does not see the opportunity to win, because just because you have representative lethal doesn't mean you actually have it. So game number 2 is in the books. But a very big win for Kit Kat, but a cool thing to note here is that Kit Kat not only won the game, but he also won knowing what his opponent's deck is. And that brings a lot of information for how the rest of the series plans out.
Yeah, it completely changed the way he chooses to mulligan against this Paladin deck now. And even just the whole game plan in general, because as we said there, as Secret Paladin, it's normally played as, like, it is the sort of you want to control the board, but it's normally the aggressor in most matchups. Whereas in that matchup, you just had to, you know, you just have to end the game quickly or it'll very quickly spiral out of control.
Right, there are still matches left for Lucas where that Murloc Paladin will actually represent a bigger threat, where he's got a better opportunity to end the game, and the suite of removal that's available to him will hopefully work out better. Having to play both Doomsayers at the same time alone was such a huge punishment to the Murloc Paladin's win condition that I don't think from that point onward, he was kind of playing from behind at all times, and that makes it very difficult to recover, stay ahead, stay alive long enough to get to a point where Anyfin is actually game-ending.
I agree to an extent. I also think another aspect to look at it is how he built out the deck. We can see that he made some choices like Humility, for example, which obviously does well with the Pyromancer. And he has like things like Loot Hoarder to improve his consistency. But there's one card that I assume that he took out that's been put in a lot of other lists, which is Muster for Battle. And I know that card is very debatable amongst Murloc Paladin specialists, but the more I see people like Nyria from Team Liquid playing it, like Kalento, for example, and even Dog, they really love that card because it's so important for the early board control, and you're not stuck just hero power, and you're playing Loot Hoarder, which is very bad tempo onto the board on your side.
Yeah, I think it's even though the deck is very thematic and has a very specific win condition, sometimes you can't ignore the power of right. certain cards, right? Like, Muster for Battle, especially in this meta, when there's a lot of, say, Zoo and a lot of other secret paladins, Muster for Battle's just so powerful that it's really difficult to ignore sometimes.
And this is one of the worst matchups that Lucas was afraid of. Druid is the Murloc Paladin Kryptonite. It is the worst matchup that it ever could have, just because of how much pressure that each minion represents, and you don't have the optimal removal every time. I've seen people start off with two Doomsayers into like Muster for Battle and Curve Out and still lose the game, despite having every card that they want in the opening hand.
Yeah, I have to wonder if this isn't actually intentional on Lucas's part, knowing that he's not on match point here, and he can choose to play out this game using this deck, force his opponent back onto the Zoo deck, which actually is a pretty favorable matchup for the Murloc Paladin, and then be in a position where his opponent is left with nothing but Zoo going into that final match into game five.
Oh man, that's always painful. You know, Druid's giving you opportunity to develop. On turn three, it's not even bad to play a Murloc War Leader, for example.
You know, it would have been okay as well.
Yeah.
Muster for Battle.
It's true. Muster for Battle.
It would have been a good card on turn three.
Pretty good card.
He doesn't actually have any cards that I would see replacing Muster for Battle for something, so I'm not going to pin him on that.
Yeah.
But it's one of those scenarios where if you play a Murloc Warleader on turn three and then you play a Murkai, that's a 5 damage 5 or a 5/5 that comes out here and charges onto the board, really helping you control it. So a little bit unfortunate draw for Lucas. He's got a bunch of reactive cards. Kit Kat, on the other hand, he's not exactly feel in his hand either. He's got a bunch of spells and like a Keeper of the Grove, maybe a Lotheb, but he's definitely going to be hoping to draw something very good in the following turns.
I actually do really like Lotheb here, though, because you know that your opponent's deck is heavily reliant on spells. You need a lot of spells to stay in the game. He's got really good tools here to kind of prevent the Murloc Paladin from doing a lot of work, developing a significant board. And at this point, we know that Lucas doesn't have any Murlocs, so he's a long ways away from doing what he wants to do.
Yeah, I think one of the things with Lotheb, though, is the way you'd play it in this deck in your own like perfect scenario is that you just wait for turn 10.
Yep.
You basically delay them. You just say, you cannot combo me in turn 10. But looking at Kit Kat's hand, he just didn't have anything else that was worth playing. So it was just like, okay, well, I kind of need to do something reasonable here. So just putting the 5/5 body on the board's okay. But normally, you just want to say, like, no, you're not doing anything turn 10. Like, that big turn is delayed one more. And especially with Druid, one more turn could really change everything.
Yeah, you're absolutely right in the sense that the deck is so many spells. I mean, he even has Humility. That's another spell as opposed to a minion like Boom. But there are a couple of key turns that you have to wait to make sure that Lotheb's maximum efficiency. One of them is turn 8, because you deny not only the lay on hands, but Pyromancer and Equality is not even accessible at that mana. You have to play Pyromancer, Equality 7 mana, you can't do it. And when you lock out, that also conveniently goes to turn 9, which is the Force of Nature Savage Roar. So that's probably the optimal turn, I would say, because that's when you set up the kill. But 10 is just like a stall turn. Very similar to an Alexstrasza on the Freeze Mage.
Exactly.
If you have no other option, yeah, definitely go for the Lotheb. Don't try to be like a really passive player. You have to be proactive. But I've seen so many times where you wish you had Lotheb later on instead of wasting it so fast in the game. But it is one of those interesting dynamics. What else do you do? You have a great turn 10 play. And that's about it.
Yeah.
And I mean, honestly, though, looking at what Kit Kat has in hand, I have to assume that the Lotheb play for him is just a way to say, you know what? I want to get to the point where I can use my removal tools and do as much damage as possible, as quickly as possible. He's going to be able to actually kill Lucas outright in two turns.
Yeah.
And that's a really incredible option to have available to you.
It's a really good point. because he could just play as aggressive as possible. However, I do think Lucas is going to get the better end of everything with that lay on hands in his hand. However, he also could just be feeling very confident. Drew's not doing anything. He's passing a lot. But that also makes you nervous, doesn't it, Kevin?
A little bit, yeah. I don't think, I mean, honestly, as the Murloc Paladin player, you don't want to assume he's got Forces of Nature double Savage Roar in hand. And you can't play around that. If you try to play around that, you've effectively already conceded. You need to just treat your game like you have an available win condition and play towards your own long-term gameplay.
Yeah, and I like this actually as well, just dropping the pyro, just creating a little bit more pressure, because we've not really seen, have we seen even any Murlocs yet?
No, not
so
a single
one. So we've not
one.
Seen any, so he's a long way away from being able to burst the druid down, so now he just needs something to actually wrestle the board. He does have double equality and double consecrate as well, so he does have answers, but it's kind of awkward doing like equality consecrate when the druid's like single dropping minions.
Yeah, I mean, this is a really rough spot to be in as the Paladin player, because this is, you're in combo range right now, so he doesn't have any real choice here but to play that lay on hands next turn. And I honestly don't know if that's what you would want to do, given the rest of your hand at this point in the game, but it's unavoidable now.
I think the benefit of lay on hands next turn would be that you can run the 1-1 in, lay on hands, hit the 1 damage from the pyro, still draw and leave the acolyte up, and then trade the pyro in as well. So lay on hands would be okay, but we do see that the 1-1's probably going to get actually picked up by the druid hero power, so it'll be a little bit more of an awkward trade, I suppose.
Yeah, but this is so appealing to play a peacekeeper here and not lay on hands, because you get to get an extra draw. Now that you drew a Murloc, you can actually snipe the Ancient of Lore too if you feel uncomfortable about the Force of Nature Savage Roar and Innervate. You can even play around that, but will you play around this four-card combination, the, you know, this absolute disaster of a turn that's going to come on this Paladin? I do not blame him at all for playing this.
No.
This seems the most rational, thought, logical, highest percentage play, but it just happens to be that 10% of the time or less that he has this two Savage Roars Force Nature. This game is over.
Yeah, and like you said, Kevin, the problem is, like, if you start to play around, like, you know, those kind of ridiculous combos, then you're playing so inefficiently that you're probably going to lose anyway. So
more times than not.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. The odds are that it's just not worth it, right?
Just not when it counts the most, because this is where your tournament life will start to, you know, you're losing a lot of it. The series isn't over, but this is definitely a painful loss.
Yeah. I mean, you can see it in Lucas's face as he just leans back and goes, well, there's nothing to be done for that.
Yeah, I think that might actually be just on the surface, of course, a bit of a problem, because he looks very disheartened and just very like, oh, whatever. You know, it's one of those things where it's like, I think you kind of just need a little bit refocus yourself. It does kind of feel bad to get comboed out that hard, but, you know, he just seems like, oh, you know, sure. And it's like, he just needs to sort of refocus and be like, yeah, I can still take this.
I mean, I still maintain I like it from a strategic perspective, right? He's still in a position where now he's got the best possible matchup against this Zoo deck. We haven't seen his mage yet. If that's a freeze mage, I don't know that there's a world in which Kit Kats has a strong out in this particular lineup. Mm. So there is very much a possibility that Lucas has actually done this intentionally.
The guy took Murloc Paladin. I think that could be Reno Mage. That's what I really want to see from this guy.
I mean, if we were to go the full circle of how deep it would go, because first of all, Reno Mage is definitely an underrated deck. I'm not sure if it's a tier one, like you would always want to bring it. It's more of a very specific pocket that you want to attack in. But I would still like to see some Tempo Mage with a little bit of flair at the end. I think Tempo Mage is definitely a deck that's underestimated by the current meta. People think Zoo is very good, therefore Tempo Mage is bad. However, it still is really effective against the Druid. It's reasonable against Paladin.
Yep.
And it even has some decent matchups against other classes as well. So I think that's also a reasonable choice.
Yeah, and I think with Tempo Mage, because I'm a big fan of the deck, mainly because I hate Freeze Mage. I hate playing it, at least. But I think like Tempo Mage is good as well, because you do just have those games where you go like mana worm,
yeah,
frostbolt their minion, and then just completely snowball from there. So, you know, it's not like it has any super hard matchups, I would say.
Yeah, it's weird. It's one of those decks that feels a lot like Druid in a strange way, where even in your worst matchups, there is still the possibility that you get the cards you need and have the outs to actually close out a game efficiently or come back and fight your way back into a game that you probably didn't deserve to be on an equal footing in the first place.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, well, it makes sense if that's given his lineup. However, with the Murloc Paladin being available and we see how everything interacts with that, maybe there is a Freeze Mage element to it because he's playing a more controlly lineup. It makes sense given his strategies. And we're going to do Zoolock versus the Freeze Mage, a matchup that is not very good for the Warlock, but it is doable.
Yeah, I definitely think the especially cards like Bran and the Peddler being able to access potential more power overwhelmings and things like that. Mm-hmm. If you can go fast enough and the Freeze Mage doesn't quite get the early controlling start or the minions to trade with, then it's definitely doable. But looking at Lucas's hand, I mean, he has two 2-drops, he has Frost Nova, and even the Thanos that we're probably going to see for Cycle when it's drawn this early in the game, especially versus a deck as aggressive as this. So I think there's, you know, Lucas in an okay spot, but Kit Kat's has got a pretty quick start himself.
I mean, right. It's rough to have two secrets in hand this early as a Freeze Mage, but honestly, I'm just going to go ahead and say I actually really like the position Lucas is in, and I do honestly believe that this was probably a strategic decision. I think he looked at the lineup, accurately predicted that this was going to be a Zoo Warlock, and said, okay, I have two available decks to me that do fairly well against Zoo, and is now in a position where he's looking at this and going, okay, now I get to play my game, and my opponent has to play around what I have to offer.
Yep, definitely. And Lucas is going to clear off there. Got pretty good value from the Scientist. Clear off the rest of the Voidwalker after a ping, and now he can get that Flame Imp off the board. And, you know, Kit-Kat is representing too much power, and that Doomguard is a real issue, because by the time he draws it, he kind of needs to make sure that there's no other, you know, no other cards in hand to get full value.
Wow, some really powerful cards just came to Kit-Kat's hand. The first is the Silence for the inevitable Doomsayer. This Dark Peddler ended up not being that great, though. It was more of a whiff.
Secret Keeper, come on.
Yeah, Secret Keeper does get buffed by every secret they play from the hand, but with two out of four already gone, I'm not anticipating it being very good.
He is, though, at least at this point, not playing too heavily into the board, so he's going to be able to sort of stick it out. That Silence does represent a ton of options, right? It can do a lot of things in this matchup. It can even be used to silence your own minion, remove the freeze effect, and use that as a way to contest the board or deliver fatal damage at some point later on.
Yeah, and seeing Lucas's just card draw then, he does have the Frost Nova Doomsayer, which is so key on turn five of dealing with a build-up board from any form of aggressive deck, and the Owl there is just going to lock that down pretty hard.
Ah, lowly squire. You know, we believe in you, my friend, but this is not going to be the kind of game we needed you for.
I mean, he might be a reasonable threat as, like, a 3-2 Flame Imp that didn't cost you health, because you're going to be life-tapping a lot pretty much almost every turn. When this Doomsayer and this Frost Nova inevitably comes down and the Silence onto it, you're going to probably life-tap one more time, and that's a reasonable-sized threat. For a one-mana card, not bad.
I mean, it has potential here, absolutely. As the Warlock player, though, I think when you're forced to use that Silence this early and your board still doesn't actually represent a lot of damage, you don't have any game-ending plans available to you just yet, he's still watching very carefully to think about what it is he's going to do to try to stay in this game. Ultimately, the Zoo player is going to have a really hard time here no matter what happens.
It's okay, though, because there's no AoE at the moment in Lucas's hand, so this Squire, in maybe five more turns, he's going to do a lot of damage.
Five more turns. Well, it's true. No AoE is really the big thing here. I like to tap first just to evaluate what you're drawing. You still want a Silence because that's 8 power you're saving by doing this. I'm definitely a big fan. The only thing that you might want to question is whether or not you fully load the board here.
Yeah, you're kind of playing into Blizzard if Blizzard is in play, and when you don't know, we've seen this actually hurt Zoo players pretty much all day when they've overloaded the board without really evaluating the risk of what that might entail. With what Kit Kats has behind this, I don't know that I love that play.
And that was the quickest selection of Power Overwhelming I think I've ever seen. I couldn't even tell what the left guard was because it just snapped Power Overwhelming so quick. It's almost like when you play Finley in Aggro Shaman and you see Hunt the Hero Power, it's just like, yep, don't need to look at the others.
Druid hero power. There's the Blizzard, so I mean, this is still actually probably not a phenomenal position to be in for Kit Kats. He's going to get a chance to do some damage here, but he can't play any minions. He doesn't necessarily want to power overwhelming that Nerubian Egg and activate it. I think, honestly, here he's forced to tap, attack, and pass.
Which isn't, again, too bad of a scenario. I think you also might even consider using a power overwhelming because your board's full and you don't get Imp Gang boss value if an AoE thing comes down. So he's using both. Okay, that's perfectly fine. You know, this Power Overwhelming is just going to be used aggressively anyways, right? So why not just use your hand efficiently so Doomguard doesn't have to worry about that whole Fibonacci scenario. Do I Doomguard first and potentially lose my game-ending damage? I like it. When you have the board, just cash in on it.
Yeah, and you do kind of want to force your opponent to start and have to protect themselves, right? At this point now, Lucas, he's out of ice barriers, so he's got to start and think about his health total. And if Kit Kat is able to continue to apply pressure, that's a significant effect.
Yeah, and the thing about the Power of Wildmans is against this specific deck, you're not trying to just burst them from 20 or something like crazy and surprise them and just kill them because of Ice Block. So you actually just need to push them low, proc the Ice Block as low a health as possible, you know, and then continue the game from there. So like you said, Dan, like the Power of Wildmans are fine. He needs the damage anyway.
Whittling away makes perfect sense here. I just don't know that I see a way out for Kit Kats yet.
Well, here's the thing. If he Blizzards, the Ice Block gets popped next turn because a 5 attack will come out from all of the Death Rattles or the summon abilities. He's going to have to actually... Oh, wait, what? All right, I misspoke. All right, first of all, I did not know that. Just because...
Oh, the freeze after the...
freeze after
the boss, yeah.
I thought that fixed because that used to be with, like, swipe. You would swipe it in the game boss.
With
and then
Blizzard,
kill the 1-1, and they fixed it. With Blizzard, they freeze it. All right,
I think it's actually a unique situation with freeze effects where damage is applied and then freeze is applied.
All right, well, today I learned. Well, there you go. I learned so that you guys don't have to feel stupid for it.
So that's one of those awkward things of having a silence Doomsayer on board with a juggler as well. Mm-hmm. We're like, oh, okay, this minion isn't really a threat, but now it's soaking up potential damage. And when, like, actually one extra damage is actually super important in this matchup, kind of sucks a little bit for Kit Kats, but I think he's in a reasonable position at the moment.
Well, it's scary, right? I mean, you as the Freeze Mage player are aware now that your first Ice Block is going to get popped next turn. There's really no way out of that at this point. So you have to start and think about, what are my follow-up turns going to look like? How do I get to a place where I actually have lethal damage? And right now, it's starting to look like he's running out of options.
Yeah, I think... Do you think you have to cash in on Emperor here? Because the Doomguard will almost probably trade into it. They'll pop the block, but then at least you get everything reduced, and then maybe even like Archmage Ice Block next turn or something just to try and gain it. It's going to be really difficult without, say, Alexstrasza in hand to then just boost your health back up.
Yeah, the biggest thing against the Emperor is that you're not actually reducing useful cards. Yeah. You're reducing cards that draw, so why not just draw instead?
Yeah.
And in this case, right over to Kit Kats, he just has to find a way to not die. He's probably even tempted to not life tap. You know, it's one of those scenarios where you have to think, do I want to lower my health to give him an opportunity to potentially even kill me? But I also want to get closer to cards like Lotheb, and because that card's awesome against Freeze Mage.
Lotheb's a good card.
Yeah.
There is a fear here, I think, and I'm actually surprised in a way that Kit Kats, and maybe I'm wrong, maybe he's going to do it right now. I'm surprised he hasn't cleared off the Thalnos, because spell damage is such a huge risk at this point in the game.
I think the point for that is that the spell damage is important, but the Freeze Mage only has 3 cards for, right, obviously, after Acolyte. So the chance on something like, you know, Frostball, Ice Lance, Fireball or something coming out in that is very slim. So I think you just take the risk, kill off the Acolyte, because then that's potential multiple card draw.
Right.
Whereas Thalnos is only going to draw 1, right? So I think you just, it's just managing the risk there.
Yeah, same as the Rogue deck, for example. They have to often choose if I draw with this or I get the spell power immediately. Versus if you kill it for them, they get the spell... They get the spell option if they draw more cards, and from so forth. So the sequencing there, definitely on point for Kit Kats. Very technical play, making sure not to life tap, not to even overextend minions, because he knows if, for some reason, the entire board is clear, he still has a knife juggler and a couple of options to kill off with lucky juggles.
Yeah, and I think he's in a good position because he has the minions that allow him not to tap. Mm-hmm. He's got such a good board that normally you can be in this position where it's like, I don't want to tap because I lower my health so much, but if I don't tap, I'm doing nothing else. So this is pretty nice for Kit Kats. We'll see what Impact Emperor has for next turn.
We also had a lot of information, right? I mean, there was every possibility that Lucas had like a defensive Alexstrasza in hand, and that would have changed the game state very rapidly. So right now, we know that Kit Kats is actually in a very aggressive position here, but I'm really concerned that there's not going to be enough left for Kit Kats to actually close out the game if Lucas is able to draw something, right? The Blizzard, the Frost Nova, anything that stalls the game and gives him an extra turn.
Yeah, this is going to be scary, though, because of that Doomsayer, Kit Kats can actually just pass, and then unless Alexstrasza comes out, then Juggler, you know, Implosion should win the game. There's always, you know, like...
If it's 4, it's guaranteed to. But if it's 3, it's like almost guaranteed. If it's 2, you probably won't. But
this is actually really interesting, though. I mean, this Healbot is going to buy Lucas another turn. He's forced to waste a lot of burn there. But if he sees another spell come out and can use Antonidas to start to cycle into some fireballs, this could turn. This game isn't over yet.
I mean, I still feel like Kit Kat's in a pretty commanding spot, just because from here, now that so many cards have been used, not the best outcome of Implosion, but I guess he'll take the juggles. He's not under threat of dying. You know, one of the biggest things that the Freeze Mage knows is that because Warlock willingly drops his own health, you don't have to actually play Alexstrasza aggressively. And then you can just use the bird, but Frostbolts, Ice Lances, Fireballs, and now Emperor has landed only on one card. I don't think you're really afraid of Lifetapping anymore.
Yeah, and he's got the dual benefit of, he's actually seen a lot of that direct burn. You know, he just saw a Fireball and a Frostbolt. Mm-hmm. We've seen an Ice Lance earlier. So, and as you said, the Mage is on one card. What one card kills someone on 19 health, you know?
Look at this, Lucas is so afraid of what might happen that he's even skipping the Arcane, or sorry, the Antonitis with the Arcane Intellect combination. And he's doing it afterwards because he wasn't sure what he was going to draw, if he needed to change his plan or not.
Yeah, because there's potential of, like, I think we've only seen one Frost Nova, right? So, like, a Frost Nova again delays the game. But, like you said, kind of awkward that, like, you draw and it's like, oh, I could have had an additional Fireball.
Oh, my goodness.
And there is a pretty good card versus Freeze Mage.
Well, you could Life Tap into Lethal. I mean, what's the only thing better than this is just game-ending damage, which is one off right now.
That's so rough. That's such a tough place to be in because you have to Lothep. You have to Lothep and just deny the spell casts, especially with Antonitis on board. And you will be threatening Lethal next turn unless the Mage draws a non-spell solution to this board.
Yeah, his best draw might be just Alexstrasza right now. And yep, that still gives him a chance. No. And no clear way out of this. Because there's just so many one yeah, ones, there's so many
there's
tokens.
So many little minions.
What's the worst? Death by, you know, a machete or death by a thousand paper cuts? They both really hurt. And in this case, it doesn't matter if you're like killing the board and removing it, you're just gonna die to all these small little annoying tokens.
Yeah, so he can actually stop Lethal on board this turn, right? Yeah, so he can
stop. There's no way.
Yeah, you can stop it from the board, but obviously with the Argus, it's going to buff the extra damage to be able to end the game. So, pretty crazy one. Zoo doing some work.
Yeah, that's not the expected outcome to see a Zoo player beat a Freeze Mage, and that went really well for Kit Kat's. Super excited, actually, to see him advance and what he's able to do in the upper bracket.
Certainly. I think one of the keys was that turn when he drew the Owl, and he was completely ready for the Doomsayer Frost Nova. No surprise there. Like, once he was able to secure that board, and he was able to get a lot of damage. I think one of the things that we didn't really also explain too well is just how much the early game damage really matters when you curve out. Sometimes the Zoo deck, because you have some higher mana cost minions, you don't always have a turn one play. You don't even always have a turn two play. But when he hit Flame Imp into Abusive Sergeant, and the Void Caller stopped the Mad Scientist from trading into it, he got a lot more damage into it. You can see from that game that almost every single damage point mattered. He only had one over lethal. So if he was missing any of that damage from turn one onwards, who knows? Maybe that gives the Freeze Mage just enough time to play their cards differently, more conservatively, and win the game.
Yeah, and even getting that first egg down relatively early was just like, there's instant protection against any sort of funky AoE or anything like that, and always a threat for the Mage that, okay, the egg's down, and then like Power of Whelming might come out, and then there's a 4-4 I've got to deal with, as well as all this early pressure.
Right, you even saw cards like Implosion that typically you love to see early on in a Zoo deck that wouldn't have been applicable because there was nothing to do with them on the board until later in the game, where you could actually start and take advantage of them, especially once all of the secrets had been cycled through. That would have been a terrible play in the early game, but ended up being the 1-1s that created that death by a thousand cuts scenario.
Yeah, I would also say that the second MVP was, like, the first, of course, the award goes to the Owl. He wins the Cy Young, but if we were going a runner-up, it would be to the Dark Peddler for giving the Power of a Whelming number two, which was also a lot of burst. These kinds of scenarios, again, you don't really think too much about it, but you know, they give a lot of advantage that stack up over time, giving Kit Kat a win where normally people put as a 30% odds to win that matchup. It's so bad for the Zoo because Freeze Mage has many answers onto the board many times over. So a job well done to Kit Kat, playing to his strengths, really making sure to be technical. And while it's a crushing loss for Lucas, I definitely expect to see him come back. I think he played the best to his hand could have, and you can't be mad outside of what deck lineup you brought.
Yeah, exactly. A lot of it will just be based on preparation and how it works out. And especially him taking a few risks maybe with like Murloc Paladin, for example. Mm-hmm. You've got to respect that a deck like that will win you some sets really hard, you know, really get a good win.
Sure.
Or, you know, you can get punished sometimes. Yeah. And we did see a few rough games from him with that one.
Yeah, I absolutely stand by what I said earlier, which is that Lucas made a really smart tactical decision in terms of the Conquest format by continuing to play and use that Murloc Paladin and ultimately put himself in a position where he did technically give himself two matchups where he would have ultimately been favored. He didn't get the draws he needed. He didn't get the ability to cycle as efficiently as he could have in that Freeze Mage deck, was punished by the MVP Owl, and in the long run, couldn't get the job done. But he made a really smart set of decisions there, and I would be really shocked not to see him go further in the lower bracket.
Who knows? The Brazilian meta we saw with another player earlier play Control Warrior and mid-range Paladin. I think Murloc Paladin is great against those decks. Maybe not necessarily against the Druids, but who knows? In the meantime, we're going to get ready to send it over to TJ for closing thoughts on that series and to tell what's happening next.
Thank you very much, guys. Great cast on the days so far. Yeah, it's great to see KitKat doing so well. I know that he's a player that a lot of people have looked up to in the past, especially when it comes to Warrior games and innovating with Warrior. He's been sort of MIA, but he always sort of makes a splash when it comes time for important matches. So we'll have to see how he does. But I believe I have KitKat standing by on the line. So KitKat, can you hear me?
I can hear you now, TJ. What's up, man?
Hey, first off, big congratulations. I know a lot of people have sort of been wanting more KitKats lately. So what does it mean to you to come into the first big event of the year and do so well so far?
It means a lot to me. You know, I've been practicing other decks outside of Warrior a lot. I'm still pretty weak with Secret Paladin. You know, I think everyone kind of saw that. I feel like I'm making some mistakes. But I mean, it just means so much to me that I'm doing well with classes outside of Warrior.
So a question, have you gotten to play Warrior at all in your matches today?
A few times, almost every single match it's banned. And so I've really had to show everyone that I played against that I can play the classes, and I think I've done pretty well today.
All right, well, cool. Talk to me a little bit about your deck preparation. Did you have any practice partners? Did you practice with anybody on a team? Talk to me a little bit about how you came to bring the decks that you brought to this tournament.
Okay, well, I always practice with my friends, and I discuss a lot of strategy. A little bit of everyone, you know, Sexo Chaki, everyone really, all the people from my old teams and everything, and you know, playing a lot of Overwatch to work on my mouse skills, you know.
All right. Well, also, that's good. You need the mechanics to play into Hearthstone. If you're behind, you got to be able to click the escape concede as quick as you possibly can.
Yeah, before they combo.
Yeah, exactly. As soon as you see that force of nature animation, you got to make sure you concede before they get the full combo up there. I just want to get your opinion on who do you think, has anybody surprised you in the tournament so far? Is there anybody looking forward to playing moving forward later today and tomorrow?
Ah, man, my bracket is stacked. I really am looking forward to Purple. You know, he's been my boy. He helped me prepare for the last BlizzCon, really, like, you know, 14 hours the night before. And, you know, he's always been really, really a great player, and I've always looked up to him. And so I really hope he does well and get to meet him in the round of 16 or 8 or whatever, wherever
yeah,
we are.
I think 16 is coming up next. Well, we'll have to check in on Purple later. But once again, KitKats, congratulations. Thanks for joining me on the interview.
Thanks so much, guys. Have a good day.
Thanks. Well, I do have some updates as well from across the Americas region for the preliminary. We're actually getting pretty far into day number one. I believe we have just a couple matches remaining. So a couple notable players to keep your eye out on. Chalky has actually made it to the upper bracket round of 16, which means he's through to tomorrow. And he just needs to win one more in order to qualify for the Americas Championship. He's still, you know, at risk of going down to the lower bracket where he'll have to fight, but keep an eye out for Chalky. VLPS of Team Splice has been eliminated from the tournament. So unfortunately, if you are a VLPS fan, you'll have to wait for him in the spring preliminaries. A lot of players are actually still fighting their way to the lower bracket. Strifecrow, Purple, who KitKats gave a big shout out to, Tides of Time, and Just Saiyan are all fighting their way through the lower bracket. So once again, we'll hopefully be able to get an update from them later, maybe check in on some of their matches. And of course, two other notable players have been eliminated. Dart, also of Team Splice, and Silent Storm of Celestial have been eliminated from the tournament. So it's been a crazy day. We still have a couple more games today, as well as a full day tomorrow of America's prelim app action. So make sure you stay tuned. Also, head out on social media. Use the hashtag HCT. You can head over to facebook.com/Hearthstone or tweet at PlayHearthstone. We've been featuring so many tweets throughout the day, so keep them coming, guys, if you want to see your tweet featured on the stream. But we're going to go to a quick break. Coming up next, I believe we have Nostum versus That's Admirable. So that's an exciting match. Don't go anywhere, guys. More Hearthstone Championship Tour action continues right after this.